We live and work in a great country with huge economic potential and tremendous opportunities. This is one of the world's most attractive countries for investment. According to the Federal Agency for State Statistics, the inflow of foreign investment into the Russian economy in 2007 amounted to $120.9 billion. Today, Russia's gold and foreign exchange reserves amount to $500 billion, whilst its stabilization fund has hoarded $150 billion.
We hear in the news in America that Russia is prospering, that they are able to sell oil and thus the economy is booming. Well, that is a half-truth. A half-truth.
This is St. Andrew's Parish, the main and also the oldest congregation of Siberian Evangelical Lutheran Church congregation. It just turned 17. Seventeen years ago, there were about seven or eight people coming to services. Now, more than 100 people come to Sunday services. There are no vacant pews. After the service, Deacon Alexei Shilin finds an equivalent of just $200 in the collection box. 17 years ago, a small group of people in Siberia began the restoration of Lutheranism, which had been totally destroyed in USSR. At that moment, all the Lutheran pastors were executed and all the Lutheran church buildings were shut down. Through dreams and prayers of young Christians, accompanied by support of Concordia Theological Seminary of LCMS, the indigenous Russian seminary was opened in Novosibirsk. It led the church, which was in the process of restoration, expand from Novosibirsk for thousands of miles.
Our territory is from Ural to Kamchatka, and in that sense, geographically, our church is the largest Lutheran church in the world.
Siberia is an immense territory. You just can't imagine how large it is, how many time zones it can be covered, and we have parishes from the Urals to almost the Far East. This takes many days by train. It is not feasible always to drive. It is not feasible to fly. I mean, it's not possible in terms of cost. So much time is consumed with travel to serve all the parishes of the Siberian Evangelical Lutheran Church. Tremendous amount of time, a tremendous amount of effort is spent this way.
Along with our church being so tiny in membership, we are the world largest by territory. And this is, of course, is extremely challenging.
From those $200 that was found in the collection box today, we need to pay salaries to the clergy, rent apartments for them, support small town congregations, drive for thousands of miles to commune people, pay for maintenance of the church buildings and help those in need. At the same time, $200 in Russia would only go as far as renting one small apartment in the outskirts of the city.
We rent two apartments in Tomsk, one in Abakan, one in Angarsk, as well as one apartment in Chelyabinsk. We incur mandatory expenses, as it is not possible to exist without renting apartments for the clergy.
Usually our pastors in America are full-time pastors. By the grace of God, they're well enough supported they can support their family on a pastor's salary. While it's not extravagant, in many cases it's at least comfortable. Of course, some of our pastors must also seek outside employment. Here in Russia, more and more, we see this necessity. Some of the places that our clergy serve are extremely poor.
Gymnastics is a sport of Russian victories, and it constitutes Russian pride. But there is another side to the medals, with which these small girls and boys would glorify their great motherland. This barrack must have been demolished 20 years ago. Angelica, a gymnastics coach, shares one room there with her five children. She lives hoping for her 14 years old daughter to qualify for the London Olympics. Angelica earns $150 a month. One third is spent on transport to and from the workplace. That's why her little baby girl Sonia, that she is holding in her arms, might have not been born. Angelica was on her way to the abortion clinic, but encountered the church instead. Now the church is supporting her. Pastors are poor, but these people who need them are still poorer. This is so even in Novosibirsk, the capital of Siberia, and one of the most prosperous Russian cities. That means that life in the other regions is even harder.
In fact, people are very poor in many of our parishes. For example, people in Hakassia just don't have any money. They have, for example, potatoes. They bring it to the church, and we eat it with a great pleasure. I work in this field and do accordingly the two things, wood carving and making furniture. My work depends on the orders I can get. If carving is needed, I do carving. If I can make some money by making furniture, I make furniture. This is basically how I earn money.
Pastor Vitaly Gavrilov serves in Tuim, a small town that you will not find on every map. However, thousands of families in Russia still remember this place with fear. Tuim, Stalin's death camp. Anyone who had any opportunity to leave this place has already moved out. Members of Pastor Vitaly Gavrilov's congregation are old people and children. Middle-aged people are into drinking or in prison. No jobs, no future. Pastor Gavrilov understands how important he is to his flock.
Have you dug out your potatoes already?
Yes, we have 40 buckets in 4 days. And I'm still sick My cough is just breaking me apart. I'm reading that newspaper on how to treat oneself, so I treat myself.
You need to go to church. Is it written in scriptures? Is any one of you sick? He should call the presbyters of the church.
Yes, I do.
Almost all the money that Vitaly gets from Novosibirsk and earns himself, then he spends on gas. He has to drive a lot. People in smaller villages and towns scattered across taiga are waiting for him. He needs to visit each and every one of them.
I'm bound by duty, which is my ministry. It's the most important thing for me.
Many of our very dedicated clergy realize that in order to be pastors, they are going to have to work at a secondary job. Some of them take very menial work just to support their families and continue to be pastors of their church. This is a very difficult situation, and in most cases that I am aware of, it in no way cuts back the pastor's service to the church. He still may conduct a number of services per week. Certainly he makes his visits to people and conducts a full ministry and works on the side. It's quite a complicated situation.
Will you get me to the railroad station?
Get in.
Pastor Andrei Ivolga has served in Angarsk since 2004. The church has sent him here. There was a congregation, but no pastor. He moved here with his wife and daughter. He left behind friends and parents in Kamchatka, thousands of miles away from here.
You see how the city authorities restored the older district. The front looks nice from the street, but the rear remains in an awful state.
Angarsk is a town of betrayed hopes. It came to existence in taiga in the 50s, when new metallurgical factories were being built here. Young engineers from all over USSR moved to work here. In the 90s, these huge plants have become private property because of the mafia deals. Thousands of people have become hostages of their new owners. There are no other job opportunities here. And people have to work for the money they are paid.
The income level of people in Angarsk is very low, and there is almost no money collections in the church. People here are not businessmen or entrepreneurs. They have to survive as well as the pastor and his family.
It's now 2 a.m. Pastor Andrei Ivolga is back from the night shift. He works as a pastor in daytime and a taxi driver for 5 nights a week. Tomorrow morning is a Sunday festivity service. Pastor Ivolga will spend the rest of the night preparing for the morning sermon.
Sunday consists of a Sunday service itself, a sermon, Bible studies, and also 2 times a week I have to go to the neighboring village, where we recently started a new mission.
A pastor in Siberia is not just a pastor, but also he is a bookkeeper, lawyer, a building maintenance engineer. A dozen of other occupations may be listed here. There is no aid available for Pastor Ivolga, as well as for his brother pastors in the other congregations.
A person incapable of self-education would have just drowned in all this. Of course, we could hire a bookkeeper, but I guess that for a congregation that barely collects any money for candles and communion wine, it will be next to impossible.
The dealings with the state here are far more complicated than in the U.S. or even in Western Europe. While there is freedom of religion, there is some control, which is not bad, because not just any group can come in and start its mission, start its church. There has to be some accountability to the government. There has to be registration. This is very time-consuming and very energy-consuming.
Andrei knows money is worth. Therefore, he speaks with gratitude about the help he receives from Novosibirsk and from our friends at Siberian Lutheran Mission Society.
With the support of Siberian Lutheran Mission Society, our church has recently bought a house for our congregation where we conduct our services. Due to this donation, and it was a gift from our friends abroad, we as a congregation may at least provide for us. It was impossible for us to pay the rent, and now it's much easier to pay for maintenance and utilities.
Yurga is a small minor city about 130 miles from Novosibirsk. Ethnic Germans who lived in the European part of USSR, beginning from the 18th century, were deported here. This is how Stalin punished the innocent people for the aggression of Hitler against USSR. These people carried their faith through mockery, their gulags, and years of exile. Pastor Alexander Hahn visits Yurga two times a month to conduct services and to talk to the church members in their native German. Parents of Pastor Alexander Hahn also underwent the repressions.
With the support of Bethany Lutheran Church, we bought and maintain this facility for the church services. Church members in my city of Tomsk collect offerings to pay for the gas so that I could come here. Sometimes I have to drive here at my own expense because people are waiting.
Church members are ready to help their pastor any way they can. There is a good harvest of potatoes this year.
They probably don't have such potatoes in America.
Oh, probably they don't.
Sure they don't. We might ship them some so they could grow them also.
People work here. It's clear that if you lie on the sofa, you will have nothing. Level of life is not the worst, but it could have been better.
From all the clergy whom we've discussed in this movie, only Pastor Alexander Hahn was raised in a Christian family. All the rest, having chosen an easy life of a Lutheran pastor in Siberia, go their way through misunderstanding and reproaches of the closest family members, through poverty of their parishioners and everyday social problems. They go to remote towns and small villages. They go, leaving behind their romantic illusions. They go, performing daily work in the world. They go, fulfilling the Great Commission.
Speaking pragmatically, mission work always brings financial losses for the church, but we do not go to collect offerings. We go to proclaim the word. And I'm sure that no pastor will leave the church because of money. We have come to serve not for money. There are simply good times, then the funds are sufficient, and there are not so good times. It means that we just have to invent how to survive through these times. And I'm very glad that pastors in our church understand that.
Being a pastor does not mean being a king. It means being a servant. It means laying down your life for your brethren in the way that Christ laid down his life for his brethren. Of course, in most cases, this does not mean death, but it means the same self-sacrificing love and that in this way he will be a servant of his people, and it's not always easy.
Every Sunday, people light liturgical candles across the huge territory of 4,000 miles in big cities and tiny villages. The body and blood of Christ are given to parishioners in Holy Communion. Every day, pastors cover dozens and hundreds of miles to visit the sick and shut-ins. It's probable that right now someone's life is saved. New people come to the church. People who are born into Christian families. People who will be able to live a different life because they will be in church from their birth. They will donate, preach, and proclaim the word to others. And this will be possible if the Siberian Evangelical Lutheran Church continues to serve her members.